It is customary for my wife and I to spend our Easter holidays in Rome with our daughter who lives and works in Rome. And this past Easter, we were walking around Campo dei Fiori. If you've ever been to Rome, you should go. It's a very beautiful area. And in doing so, we saw this ad for a manifestation of the work of Leonardo da Vinci, and I thought this would be quite appropriate in our presentation to Vincenzo Balzani. Of course, Leonardo was known for his big machines, unlike our awardee today. And so, Leonardo had many attributes, which I've listed here. Painter, sculptor, architect, scientist, musician, he was almost everything. But most of all, he epitomized the Renaissance humanist ideal in the time of the Renaissance. And here are some of his works. The Big Machines, the Mona Lisa, the Last Supper in Torino. and our awardee, Vincenzo Balzani, whom I've known now for almost 42 years, I hate to say. It was a beautiful meeting in May 1975 when I went to University of Bologna for my first sabbatic leave. At the time, I was an associate professor on sabbatic leave. And Vincenzo shares some of the attributes of Leonardo da Vinci. As a scientist, he has received many, many awards. And he's one of the most highly cited chemists in Italy. And probably also in Europe, within Europe. He's a member of several academies, this academy, the Academia Europea, and of course, the Accademia dei Lincei in Rome. He's a prolific writer, over 600 papers, many books, and he has been cited over 39,000 times for a citation index of 98, very close to 100. But most of all, Vincenzo is a humanist. And it's that which I want to emphasize. And Vincenzo believes that scientists have a certain responsibility that comes from knowledge and strongly believes that a scientist's duty is to educate and help decision makers to find solutions to societal problems. And he also believes that scientific research and education go hand in hand with regard to such themes as chemistry, science and society, science and peace, and particularly the energy problem. And in this regard, his book, Energia per l'Astronave Terra, received the Galileo Award in 2009. That book was translated by yours truly, and it's now also available in English with Nicola Armaroli, Vincenzo Balzani, and myself. If you want to know any about the energy powering planet, it's called Power Planet Earth, Energy Solutions for the Future. It's available on Amazon for less than 25 euros. I get nothing out of it. Now, Balzani and his group back in 1987 wrote an article that appeared in the book Supramolecular Photochemistry, edited by Vincenzo and others. In 1987, and also Vincenzo and Franco Scandolo from the University of Ferrara wrote an article on the supramolecular photochemistry for the chemical molecular devices in sensor and actuators in 1990. And one of the things I want to point out to you, this is what the 1987 article said. The aim of this paper is to describe photochemical molecular devices, to review their possible applications, to single out the molecular components and to examine the requirements needed for these components and for the entire device. And it was only later that he began his collaboration with Jean-Pierre Sauvage of Strasbourg and Fraser Stoddart. At the time he was in Manchester? He was in England, anyway, he was in England or Scotland at the time. Vincenzo's work was summarized in two books, which have been translated in two or three languages, Japanese, Chinese as well. The first edition was in 2003. The second edition was in 2008. And here is Fraser Stoddart, who came all the way from Evanston, Illinois. He's now at Northwestern to congratulate Vincenzo for his 80th birthday. And we had a great time last November in Bologna. And therefore, it is my pleasure to present to you Vincenzo Balzani, who has been awarded the Leonardo da Vinci Award in recognition of his many outstanding contributions to the development of major branches of chemistry, including photochemistry, supramolecular chemistry, and molecular nanotechnology. And with this, Vincenzo, it's your floor.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I am deeply honored to be here with you today to receive the Leonardo da Vinci Award. I would like to thank the Scientific Committee for the award and my dear friend, Dick Serpone, for the nice presentation. First of all, I'd like to bring you the greeting of my university that you know from yesterday, from the lecture of my colleague Margherita Ventura, was founded in 1888. But in the old time of the universities, at the beginning, the topics were essentially theology, law, and to a minor extent, natural sciences. In an attempt to understand the origins of natural phenomena, the activity of early scientists was simply that of observing and contemplating nature, so that knowledge was very superficial. And we can say that in those old times, scientists knew almost nothing of almost everything. Starting with Leonardo da Vinci, Galileo, and later on Newton, scientists began to realize that there was something more interesting and more useful to do than simply observing and contemplating nature. They realized that nature can be interrogated and can also be forced to reveal its secrets. This can be done, of course, by experiments. So, since Newton's time, science expanded in an exponential way, and as a consequence, there has been a separation among the various topics. Today, if a scientist wishes to do something new, something interesting, he has to be highly specialized in a very narrow field. Therefore, we can say that whereas in the old times, scientists knew almost nothing of almost everything, okay, today, scientists know almost everything of almost nothing. And as you know, sometimes it happens that a scientist to talk about the almost nothing in which he is highly specialized, it happens that almost nobody can understand what he's saying. I hope it will not be the case for my lecture today. So people believe that scientists, if are fully immersed in their thoughts, to create new ideas. A scientist, people say, is a genius. I am sure that you agree with me that he's a genius, but according to the definition given by Thomas Edison, genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspirations. We know very well, indeed, the scientists are first and foremost people who work hard. The creative idea is a flash, but then there is to put the ideas into practice. Scientists sometimes do have original ideas, sometimes, but one does not need a notebook for brilliant ideas, since they are exceptionally rare. And another famous scientist, Ed Wilkinson, in his book, The Creation, said that scientists seldom make leaps of the imagination. For most of the time, they work like bookkeepers. So we should not give ourselves airs, but at the same time, we should be proud because we can contribute to build all together the beautiful cathedral of science. Now, let me go back for a moment to the title of my talk, Chemistry and Creativity. Might seem somewhat audacious, this title. For many economists and policymakers, chemistry is nothing else than a horrific school subject. And for most common citizens, chemistry means pollution, sophistication. So combining chemistry with creativity is a bit osé, probably. But I'm sure that none of you blames me for this title, because you know that chemists can indeed create new molecules, new processes, new concepts. But what does it mean, creativity? Which is the origin of creativity? I will show you some definition proposed by some illustrious scientists. Creativity is joining existing elements with new connections. Novelties come from previously unseen association of old material. To create is to recombine. Creativity thinking in science is mainly concerned with searching for fresh, meaningful combination of old pieces of information. You see, they are quite similar. Connect, associate, combine old elements in a novel way. I like more, however, the next one, which has inspired also our work. Creativity is to see what everybody else has seen and to think what nobody else has thought. Now, let me illustrate some fundamental concepts of photochemistry. When a molecule absorbs a photon of suitable energy, it is promoted from its electronic ground state to an electronic excited state, usually denoted by an asterisk. Now, the excited state is a new chemical species that can exhibit properties quite different from those of the ground state. Take, for example, formaldehyde. Now, there is a comparison between the ground state and the lowest excited state. The energy content of the lowest excited state is 76 kilocalories more than the ground state. And as you see, in the excited state, the molecule is no longer planar but pyramidal, the dipole moment is smaller, and the carbon oxygen distance is longer. And the remarkable general property is that an excited state is always a better oxidant and a better reductant than the ground state. Now, because of its higher energy content, an excited state is a transient species that must undergo fast deactivation. Deactivation can occur essentially in three ways: by means of a chemical reaction, giving a product, or luminescence, or a conversion of the excess electronic energy into heat. Now, so it is clear that photochemistry is based on light absorption, which is by itself an important branch of chemistry. Absorption spectroscopy, of course, very useful in analytical chemistry. And photochemistry is also connected with luminescence, and which is another branch, important branch of chemistry, of analytical chemistry, emission spectroscopy. Now, from a chemical viewpoint, the excited state can give rise to two types of processes, processes in which the original molecule undergoes some kinds of reaction by itself, dissociation, isomerization, and these are called intramolecular photoreactions. But if these intramolecular deactivation processes are not very fast, the excited state has a chance to go around in the solution to encounter another species, giving rise to important processes like energy and electron transfer processes, which are really very important in photochemistry. Now, energy and electron transfer processes, when there is an energy transfer process, You see, an excited state of another species is created, which will undergo its own deactivation processes. And in electron transfer processes, it may happen that the excited state gives or receives an electron from the other species. Now, the chance to give energy transfer or electron transfer is, of course, much higher when the other molecule is already, since the beginning, very close to the excited state, so there is no need for the excited state to go around in the solution. And this happens in the so-called supramolecular systems. Supramolecular system, as you can see here, the excited state is already linked by some kind of chemical bond, doesn't matter which bond it is, to the other molecule. So energy transfer, electron transfer are facilitated, of course. Now, to explain what the supramolecular system is, and also maybe to explain something more fundamental concerning chemistry, it is quite useful to make a comparison between chemistry and language. So the elementary units of language are letters, of course, of the alphabet. The elementary units of chemistry are the atoms of the periodic table. In a language, letters generally are not used in isolation, but they are combined in groups to form words. And similarly, in chemistry, the isolated atoms are not important at all. We normally work with ensemble of atoms, which are molecules. So the molecules can be defined as the words of chemistry. And in a language, of course, a word has an added value compared to the component letters. And likewise, in chemistry, a molecule has an added value with respect to the ensemble of the separated component atoms, because the interaction of the atoms in the molecule leads to novel properties, which are called emerging properties. We will see they are very interesting later on. So molecules are the object of chemistry. Molecules are very small objects, nanometer scale, and are characterized by several factors: dimension, composition, structure, shape, and such characteristics give them specific properties. Chemistry deals with molecules, not with separated atoms. Language, of course, doesn't stop to words. To express a concept, we use a combination of words that is a sentence. Likewise, in chemistry, we do not stop to molecules. To get more interesting properties, maybe more interesting function, we need to combine molecules into the so-called supramolecular system. I will show you an example in the next slide. So we can say that molecules are the word of chemistry, and supramolecular system the synthesis of chemistry. To understand what the supramolecular system is, look at the next slide. We have three different molecules. In solution, they self-assemble to yield a supramolecular system. And we will see later that there are some emerging properties. But let's continue to examine the analogy between chemistry and language. The words needed to make a sentence are chosen and ordered according to the rules of language. So, for example, ghost needs to be placed after child and two before school, because each word contains information elements through which it can or cannot interact with other words. It follows that in a sentence, owing to the combination of the information elements carried by each word, new meaning arise, of course, that cannot be present in the single words that constitute the sentence. And this is also true for molecules. Each molecule contains information elements through which it can or cannot interact with other molecules. So with these three molecules in solution self-assemble, and they do that in a very specific way, in a very characteristic way. And so in supramolecular system like this one, the combination of the properties of the information elements containing in each molecule reveals properties of the supramolecular system that cannot be present, of course, in the separated molecule. For example, in this case, in this supramolecular system, excitation with a photon of this unit leads to transfer of an electron to the other one. And this, was, of course, cannot take place in the separated systems. So supramolecular chemistry is essentially to design and prepare molecular components with appropriate size, form, structure, and also with specific properties, chemical, photochemical, redox. And in favorable cases, such components can be designed for self-assembly. And when self-assembly is not possible, they can be linked together in the appropriate sequence by the methods of organic synthesis and so on. And the supramolecular systems are obtained because of the combination of the properties of the components can give, have emerging properties and can play some specific function. We will see they are molecular device and machine. So supramolecular chemistry can also be defined as molecular level engineering. And since we are talking about objects which are in the nanoscale, this is also nanotechnology. Now let's go back to the macroscopic world. What is a device or a machine in the macroscopic world? It is something material that uses energy to perform a function. For example, a car or a light traffic or a hard dryer or even light traffic. And we can see the energy use can be a fuel here, electricity here, and light here. Now, if we wish to extend this concept to the nanoscopic world, of course, the material can only be a molecular level system, capable of using energy, chemical energy, electrical energy, light, to perform a function that may be a chemical reaction or maybe signal processes or mechanical movement. So molecular level devices and machines are objects of this kind. Molecular level system of nanometric dimension, capable of performing a function when they are stimulated by an energy input. We will see that the most interesting molecular devices and machines are those in which energy is given in the form of light. And also are those systems which are able to process light signals. Now this is our book already shown by Nick on molecular devices and machines. The cover picture you see is a drawing of a macroscopic machine of Leonardo, and there is a scheme of one of our molecular level machines. This book, as already mentioned by Nick, has been translated in Chinese, and correction of the draft of the Chinese edition was very easy because we were only asked to check our names. And so molecular devices and machines can be subdivided into two big families on the basis of the type of function performed. Maybe subdivided into devices for signal processes or machines for mechanical movements. Now, let's see some example. Other example have already been shown yesterday by Margherita. So, plug socket is a well-known device in the macroscopic world. To make a plug socket system at the molecular level, we have used a molecule that can play the role of a socket, a molecule that can play the role of a plug, and an acid-base mechanism to disconnect the two species, and a light signal which is transmitted from the socket to the plug when they are connected, not when they are, when they are not connected, it cannot happen. And you know that in the macroscopic world, we must be careful to choose the right size of the plug. And this is also true in the nano world. If we take phenyl instead of methyl, nothing happens. Then we have constructed the molecular level device that behaves like this macroscopic system. We have used the compound of this type already seen, which, as you can see, can play the role of an elongation cable because there is a socket here and the plug here. And then we have used this, which is again a two-component system, which is a socket here, and here there is a ruthenium complex that we will see also later on, that when it is excited by light, it emits an electron. And then we have a third component, which is a socket. Now, these three species, as already mentioned, they associate in solution. And they associate in a very specific way. As we have already seen, when they are associated, the excitation of this component causes transfer of electron to the third component. Now let's see briefly some linear molecular motors. A linear molecular motor can be designed starting from these types of supramolecular system called rotaxanes, in which the thread contains two different recognition sites for the ring, two different stations, so to say. Initially, the ring surrounds the station which offers the stronger interaction. But by a suitable external stimulus, we can deactivate the interaction of the ring with the stronger station. So the ring moves to the other one. By a reverse stimulus, we can go back. One of the compounds of this type that we have investigated is shown in the next slide. It consists of an electron donor crown ether and a thread along which we have two electron accepting stations, one stronger and one weaker. Upon the protonation of this unit, this station is no longer able to interact with the ring. That moves to the other station. Upon addition of acid, we can go back. This kind of mechanical movement is powered by chemical energy, addition of acid or base. And therefore, there are around the products of the reaction, which means we have some waste. Then we have used this type of approach for making a more complex system with Fraser-Stodd. We have connected three identical threads, each one containing two different electron acceptor units. And then we have made a platform connecting three identical electron donor ring. In solution, these two compounds self-assemble. And then we can put at the end of each of the thread a bulky group to prevent dissociation. This is the CPK model of the system. And this is a scheme which shows that at the beginning, the three rings of the platform stay around the three strong electron donor of each column. Now, if we add the base, we can take away the protons, and so we can stop the interaction here, which means that the platform has to go down. And by an opposite stimulus, that is by addition of acid, we can go up. So in principle, one could say this is something like a molecular lift. But if we look more carefully, and as we can see from this animation, it is not really a very good lift because, of course, the three acid-base reactions do not take place simultaneously, but one at a time. So the platform goes down in a very strange way. And again, in this compound, like in the previously seen rotaxan, is powered by chemical energy, bases and acid, with an unavoidable formation of waste. Now, indeed, the use of chemical fuels to cause the formation of chemical waste, like in the macroscopic world, and should be removed, but it is, of course, difficult in this system. So we should find a way to move something without generating waste. And this can be done by using light instead of chemical energy to power the system. But we need a reversible photochemical reaction, otherwise there is the same problem. Now, using light instead of addition of acid and base has several advantages that I cannot discuss for time reason. So we decided to make a light power molecular motor, possible power by sunlight. And we started from the simplest case of a two-station rotaxan type structure. Of course, to exploit light, we need in the system a molecule able to absorb light. And our experience in photochemistry suggested us to choose the already seen ruthenium trisbipyridyl complex that was placed as at the end of the structure, as a stopper. Now, upon absorption of a photon, this complex releases an electron. And the electron has to go somewhere. We will see where it's going later. Now, after many discussions, very careful planning, we designed this system and asked Fraser Stoddard to synthesize it. It is made of a crownator ring, which is an electron donor, and a thread that comprises five units. The ruthenium complex, which is in charge of using sunlight, a rigid spacer for kinetic reason, and two electron acceptor units. This is stronger than that, so the electron donor at the beginning stays here. We supposed that the system could work in this way. When a photon arrives on the ruthenium complex, the excited state of the ruthenium complex becomes a stronger reductant, so it gives an electron. And the electron goes, of course, in the most suitable place, which is the stronger electron acceptor. But once the electron arrives here, the ring is not glad because the ring is an electron donor. So the ring has to move to the other station. But what happens is very important, that the electron that has arrived from the ruthenium complex, as soon as the ring has moved, the electron goes back. So the ring has also to go back. And this can be maybe better appreciated from this animation. Here we have the two electron acceptor station. This is the ring, and this is the ruthenium complex. When the photon arrives, the ruthenium complex ejects an electron that goes here. But when the electron arrives here, the ring is not glad, as I told you before. So the ring will move to the other electron acceptor. But very fast, the electron goes back, so the ring has to go back also. This result was highlighted in several journals and so on. But I am almost very close to the end of my talk. But before closing, I'd like to make a brief mention of the very important topic. Suggestion comes from our book, Molecular Device and Machine, because in this book we did something quite unusual. After having described in 16 chapters all the scientific and technological aspects of this field, we have added another chapter, the 17th, as a final chapter. The reason why we decided to write such an additional chapter I explained in this introduction. This book deals with science, mostly with basic science. Therefore, it could, some readers will say it should, have ended with the previous chapter. But nowadays, can science be treated as a separated, neutral, and aseptic item? Can a scientist ignore the problems of human society and isolate himself in an ivory tower? We believe not. We believe that there is a great need to debate the role of science and scientists in our society, and that a scientific book offers an opportunity that should not be missed concerning this problem. So we have discussed in this chapter the role of science in our time. To recall, first of all, to ourselves and also to our colleagues, the social responsibility of scientists. Scientists must carefully control that science and technology are used for peace, not for war, for preserving the planet, not for destroying it, for reducing the gap between developed and underdeveloped countries, and for alleviating poverty. Of course, all of us agree on this concept, but perhaps we do not discuss them enough with our students. To finish with, I'd like to show you this beautiful image to thank the many people, starting with my family. Special thanks then go to Fraser Stodd and to my colleague and students of the University of Bologna, and I'd like to thank you for your attention.